mountains of Mecca, what can you say of the day that Abraham passed your way? And he was instructed by God to build a house of peace where people will pray. And they will come on every lean camel and out of every ravine for the purpose of praising Allah, to glorify Allah. O mountains of Mecca, what can you tell of the day that stones from the sky fell, destroying an army determined to break the house of Allah that Abraham built? O mountains of Mecca, how was the dawn on the day that my prophet Muhammad was born? How did it feel knowing he was to be the last and most beloved of all, Rasul of Allah, Nabi of Allah? O mountains of Mecca, you were there when the Prophet Muhammad climbed down in despair. Engraved in his heart were the words of his Lord to all of mankind. This was his call: La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. O people, praise only Allah, glorify Allah. Mountains of Mecca, how did you mourn on the day that the beloved returned to his Lord? And up till the last breath escaped from his lips, he prayed that his Ummah would find success. O mountains of Mecca, how will it feel when the earth shall quake and tremble with fear, and we shall be gathered together to stand in the court of Allah with our deeds at hand? Oh, how we pray that on that day we'll be with those to whom Allah will say, peace be with you, I am pleased with you. O mountains of Mecca, bear witness that I to the oneness of Allah do I testify. For all that he's given me, how can I deny? My purpose in life should be only to cry, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, Muhammad is his messenger. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, Muhammad is his messenger.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today we continue our journey about the great four Imams. And we have already covered in very brief information about Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Al-A'zam, as they used to call him, the great Imam. And today, inshallah, we are going to begin again a very brief summary of his life. We only have a very short time to do it in. Of Imam Malik ibn Anas, another giant from the giants of the scholars of Islam. I'd like to clarify two things from last week's topic. I mentioned that Abu Hanifa sat in one of the classes of Imam Malik when Imam Malik was only 13 years old. I'd like to correct that by saying that Imam Malik was not 13 years old at the time. He was 13 years younger than Imam Abu Hanifa. Imam Malik began his circles of knowledge, and he actually became at the qualification of a mufti, mujtahid, one who can actually look at Quran and hadith by themselves raw and bring out new verdicts, new rulings for very new circumstances that haven't existed before. That's a mufti and a mujtahid. It's not very easy to be like that. When he was 21 years old, he became that mufti. And he said, Imam Malik, he said, I did not give any fatwa. I did not begin giving fatwa until I had 70 great scholars who had qualified me. How many great scholars? And we're not talking about just any person, like what when you bring people along and they vote, 70 people. Who thinks Imam Malik can give a fatwa and then you get the laymen or common people like us? No. These were 70 of the greatest imams, fuqaha, jurisprudents, scholars of Medina, 70, who qualified him to be ready. They said, you are now ready to derive your own opinions, obviously based on dalil, from raw Quran and raw hadiths. That's something beyond measure. And I am very sad to see that a lot of people these days, and a little bit in the past as well, very quick to give fatwas, and they like calling people over to them and to answer questions, any question that comes up, and they feel embarrassed if someone asks them a question they can't answer it. They have to make up something. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever lies on my tongue deliberately, let them earn or preserve their place in hellfire. And I'm going to come back to that, inshallah, a little bit later on, about giving fatwas by these imams, what they thought of it. The second clarification I wanted to make from last week's topic, I mentioned that there was a group of people in Kufa, in Iraq, new group of people with a new, strange, dangerous idea that were called the Khawarij. I mentioned that one of their beliefs was that they would say that a person is a kafir by merely committing any sin at all, even a minor sin. And I gave some examples. I'd like to correct that by saying it wasn't a minor sin. They made a person a kafir only when they did a major sin, like drinking of alcohol or zina. Just to clarify that, and knowledge belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We only use what we can, and we have to be very careful. If we make a mistake, we correct it. My brothers and sisters in Islam, I'd like to start by saying there were many schools of thought in history. These madhahib, when you talk about Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i and Hanbali, people who say these things, there were actually many schools of thought under great imams. But for some reason, they were short-lived because of some political reasons or other reasons. And it was amazing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed these four schools of thought to remain until today. The Hanafi madhab, Maliki madhab, Shafi'i madhab and Hanbali madhab. Some of the examples of short-lived madhabs of the past were people like led by Shaykh Ibrahim al-Nakha'i and al-Layth ibn Sa'd and Awza'i, etc., etc. These names, you probably haven't heard of them, but they were schools of thought that existed. And when you hear about, I don't know if you heard about your parents or grandparents or some people around in the community who assume that if a man, for example, has physical contact with a woman, then he loses his wudu, or the woman has any physical contact, just a touch, shaking of the hand, they lose their wudu. Obviously, scholars differed on that, but Imam Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, who was a teacher of Abu Hanifa, he is the one who began this opinion. That was his opinion, based on his own dalil. He saw this. And it made its way into the Hanafi school of thought somehow. Now first, also, I'd like to say that my references for this, where do I get all my information from, some people ask me. There are many books, but unfortunately in English you can't find many of them that talk about the lives of these four imams in English. The best one that I found that talks in English, what I found, was one called The Four Imams, Lives, Works, and Schools of Thought by Muhammad Abu Zahra. That's in English. It's okay, it's good in the English language. But other books I used were books like Sir A'lam al-Nubala, the biography of the noble emblems. And that's only in Arabic, I don't know if it's in English. A great book about the great predecessors. And also a book called The Four Imams by Mustafa Shaka. I also use various lectures of historians and imams from around the world just to see their view on the subjects. I also used a little bit of Tariq al-Tabari. I don't know if you know about that. It has information that's authentic and information that I don't know where it came from. And some of it boggles your mind sometimes. But these imams used to mention everything. The good thing about them is that they always mentioned where they got this information from, who narrated it by who, and they gave their opinion about its authenticity. But they still mention it so that you know. I'm not sure which imam taught his son 30,000 hadiths. And after he memorized the 30,000 hadiths with all their narrations, he said to him, son, now it's time to learn the authentic hadiths. All these 30,000 were unauthentic. And we're talking about hundreds of years ago. So what about us poor people today? Alhamdulillah, we have great scholars who have looked over these hadiths and these narrations. And I think today we have a lot of information, a lot of authenticity, alhamdulillah. Scholars went over and over them again. Imam Malik ibn Anas. We'll have to hurry it up for time, insha'Allah. And the theme is the word of Allah, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. The ones who truly fear their Lord are the scholars. When you know Allah more, you fear Him more. And the fear that I'm talking about is God consciousness. God consciousness, righteousness, iman. They did the good, even the tiniest of good, and they stayed away from the tiniest of bad out of fear of Allah and out of love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the ulama. And we are not talking about knowledgeable people who know information, able to regurgitate information and tell you this information. No, these are not ulama, these are not knowledgeable people. You've got criminals who are very good at hacking the NASA station, if you like. Very good at hacking internet, you know, networks. Very good at doing all these sorts of things. And they are extremely knowledgeable in their area of programming and the sorts. But are they ulama? No. When we talk about ulama, we talk about morals and character before information. Imam Malik ibn Anas. I compare him to Imam Abu Hanifa in this way. If I were to describe both of them with a title, I would say that Imam Abu Hanifa's title for me would be the intellectually sharp and the loving. He's very loving and intellectually sharp. The way I would describe Imam Malik in one title would be that he was a man of aura, a man of absolute respect, meaning I don't mean that, I mean every scholar was a man of aura, but when I talk about Imam Malik, Imam Malik had features that Allah had created for him. He was a tall man, wide-chested, broad-chested man, wide eyes, strong-looking man, and he was blonde hair, white face, and some narrations say he had blue eyes. His beard was long until it reached his chest. He wore the most elegant and eloquent clothing. And this is what he differed with the other imams in, is that he loved wearing eloquent clothing of the best kinds. When you looked at him, even if you didn't know that he was an imam, his features strike you. And you find something inside of you forcing you to respect this man. We call this in Arabic haiba, an aura, the man of aura. This man, Imam Malik ibn Anas, his father was a tabi'i. We said tabi'i means that a person who met sahabas and died after they met them, believed in them. Imam Malik was a tabi'i. He met the people who met the sahabas. His grandfather, the grandfather of Imam Malik, his name was Malik ibn Anas as well. And he was a tabi'i. And his great-grandfather was a sahabi. His name was Abu Amir. His grandfather, Malik ibn Anas, was a friend of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. And he was one of those who made copies of the Qur'an after the battle with Musaylam, when a lot of memorizers of the Quran had been killed. He was one of those who carried the body of Uthman radiallahu anhu to the Baqiyah. And he lived till the time of the Khalifa Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, and he died when his great grandson Imam Malik, our hero tonight, was only 7 years old. Imam Malik started his knowledge at the age of 10 years. There is no limit to when a person starts his education, knowledge, there is no limit to how far they keep learning. And when I talk about starting 10 years, in those days, the children of those days were not like today. And unfortunately, the society and state we live in makes people, teenagers who are 16, 17, 20 years old, seem like they're still children. Oh, they're just teenagers, let them have a good time. Let them go on a little bit of drugs, have a good time and drink some alcohol, hang out with a few girls, go to the nightclubs. They're just teenagers. And when they hit 18, they start their alcohol and stuff and they make it legal for them as though they now become responsible when they haven't even raised them on responsibility. In those days, you're talking about 10-year-old was like a 20-year-old today. Imam Malik at 10 years of age started his knowledge. And he spent his whole life in Medina, Medina al-Sharif, Medina al-Munawwara, in the land of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never left Medina al-Munawwara his entire life, only to Mecca when he went and did Hajj or Umrah. In fact, not only did he ever never leave Medina al-Munawwara in his life until he died, and he lived for 90 years. 90 years he lived. Never left Medina al-Munawwara. He never even rode on a camel or any transport vehicle in his entire life when he was living in Medina. Does anyone know why? Because in his wara, in his righteousness and love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as a role model, he saw benefiting in himself as the scholar of Medina to always have his feet stuck to the ground of the land where the body of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is buried. He saw it disrespectful as an imam representing his deen in the highest esteem to lift himself off the ground out of respect for the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam while his body was in the ground. Never in his life did he ever lift his legs off the ground. Can you imagine that? 90 years. Except when he went to Hajj or Mecca outside of Medina. When the Khulafa, the rulers, when he went to meet them, and the rulers were in Iraq, in Baghdad and Kufa and those areas, he never left to see them there. Whenever he wanted to give them advice, he waited when they came to Hajj, to Mecca. If he was there, he'd meet them in their residential palaces. And when they came to Medina, he would go to their residential palaces and meet them there and advise them. He never went to a ruler for any need for himself or for any need of that ruler. So he never responded to a ruler to come for a need of that ruler, and never did he go there to ask for something. The only time he ever went to the rulers or officials was for only one reason, was to advise them when they had erred. And this is the trait of all the imams, all the scholars, and especially the four imams. My brothers and sisters, the four imams, even though they differed in some opinions of branches of the branches of the religion, branches of the branches, we're talking about where to place your hand, we're talking about what breaks your wudu in minute detail. We're talking about things like, if I want to send my udhiyah, is it better to send it to my relatives, or is it better to send it to poor people? And they had differences of opinion, like that. Nothing major at all. The problem is that Muslims today, we make it major. And even in those days, there came a time, we'll talk about inshallah later on, where people got so obsessed with their madhab, it became like a cult. That in Mecca itself, they prayed four jama'as behind four imams because they were behind four different madhabs. This is division. There is a difference between difference of opinion and division. The scholars, even the sahabas, had differences of opinions, but they did never divided. And those of us who divide based on that, wallahi, you do not know the scholars, the imams at all. You don't know their teachers, because they respected each other. They followed each other. They took from each other. They conversed with each other. And they learned from each other. And a lot of them, their scholars and their teachers were each other's teachers. They learned off each other. So it's ignorance, no matter how much information you know, to cause division in your knowledge. If your knowledge is causing division in the people and this is your action, then you have no knowledge. So Imam Malik was one of those. To talk a little bit more about him, he was born in the year 93 Hijri in Medina, about the year 760. And he died in the year 179 Hijri, 86 or 90 years old. And they all followed each other in the way they were born. He met Imam Shafi'i, and he met the great students of Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Qadi Abu Yusuf and others, and learnt off them. His father was a handicapped man. He was handicapped in part of his body, paralyzed. And he earned a decent living making arrows. But his father was a muhaddith. He was a great scholar as well. So he came from a line of great scholars, Imam Malik. Unlike Abu Hanifa, who number one, learned his knowledge later, when he was about 20, Imam Malik learned it at 10. Unlike Abu Hanifa, Abu Hanifa stumbled on learning knowledge. He was passing by, as we said last week, and the Imam al-Shaybani, he saw him, and he said to him, "Where are you going?" He said, "I'm going on business." He said, no, business. Don't distract yourself with business. I can see intelligence in your face." And he swerved him, he made him come into knowledge. Imam Malik was not like that. Imam Malik lived the life of religion in the masajid from his childhood. And there was a turnaround point in his life in how he went into knowledge. Very interestingly, I'd like to say that his father played a role in his turnaround, but his mother played the biggest role. And I hope the sisters are listening to this. The mother of Imam Malik is the person who charted the future of Imam Malik. She is the one. You know how they say behind every great man is a great woman? I'm not talking about husband and wife. We're talking about mother and child. And we're going to talk about that in a minute. His brothers and sisters, he had three brothers and one sister. One of his brothers, his older brother by the name of Al-Nadir ibn Anas, he was the man of knowledge. In Medina, everybody talked about his older brother Al-Nadir as being the most knowledgeable. Right up to the point where Imam Malik became afterwards the most knowledgeable, and his brother Al-Nadir was forgotten about. They never said, they used to say, Malik the brother of Imam Al-Nadir. When Imam Malik reached his position by the will of Allah, they started calling Al-Nadir, Al-Nadir the brother of Imam Malik, the other way around. His upbringing, Imam Malik had a boyish upbringing. He was a cheeky little boy when he was a child. And he didn't listen to his parents much. They had a bit of a hard time with him. We say in Arabic, kashish hamam. He had pigeons and used to herd pigeons. That's what he used to do as a child. And he liked mucking around a lot as a child, very active. But he had, from a young age, this haiba. He didn't like people messing around with him. He got angry at when his honor was broken, but his anger was always maintained and channeled by his mother. The story begins like this. Imam Malik was about 9 or 10 years old when he was sitting at the dinner table, or sitting, they used to sit on the floor around and they used to always share dinner. His father, and I want you to watch something very carefully about how parents brought their children up. His father tested his children with a fiqh question. Fiqh means knowledge of the Islam in things that we practice. Your prayers, your wudu, inheritance, riba, all these things are in fiqh. Understanding of the laws in every way. So he asked the fiqh question. He asked it to Imam Malik. Malik didn't know the answer, but his older brother knew the answer quickly. And this, his father said to Malik, Al-haka al-hamamu anil ilm. The pigeons distracted you from knowing knowledge. And this struck Imam Malik right in the heart as a child. It angered him. But his anger was channeled, as I said, it angered him to make a decision. Not to fight with his brother or to get jealous. This anger, a Muslim, mu'min's anger, is directed in a different way. The anger was the motivation to make him look forward, be optimistic and choose a pathway to make something out of himself. So this anger made him think of becoming a knowledge. That was one aspect of maybe of which caused his turning point. The other aspect was that his mother, when she saw that he was angry, she took him and made him take a shower. Then she dressed him with really nice clothing. And she put perfume on him, and she made him look really ready, well-groomed, presentable, in the highest esteem. And she said to him, I'm going to take you to learn knowledge behind the imams in Medina. He said, but mother, I want to become a singer. Would you believe that? Imam Malik, he wanted a career as a musician, to become a singer. He had a nice voice. But his mother, now I want the mothers to listen again, the fathers. She didn't say things like, no, it's haram, son, or you shouldn't do that. Nor did she say, oh, that's a good one. It's a money-making career. You should do it. Good on you. Let me hear your voice. No, no, no. His mother was very smart and wise. A child needs to be taught and fed with the spoon. You need to have patience. You need to repeat your words lots and lots of times. Have patience with them. So instead of saying all these things, this is what she said. Malik, you know, singing is not just about the voice. Singing comes with good looks. And you don't have it. You don't have good looks. You don't have it. You don't have what it takes. So, you know, the X Factor and the, the Australian Idol and all that, you know, they never pass someone with the most magnificent voice. This is what people are always telling me, unless they had the look with it. And what kind of a look, waliyadu billah, in these days they want for singers. I'm talking about hundreds of years ago. Talking about you know, 100 or so years after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this is what singers were always about. You have to come with the look, because people have to look at you, otherwise your voice means nothing. So this, you know, made him become demotivated. So I haven't got the look. Yeah, a child believes his mum. He doesn't know anything about looks, a child. They haven't got the look. Even though Imam Malik was very good looking. But his good looks was one of respect. It wasn't the one of attraction that made you look at him and think, oh, how gorgeous he is. No, it was like, he's a good looking man, but I wouldn't dare to tell him that. It was like that. He was had that aura, as I said before. So she took him to the Medina Masjid al-Nabawi. Over there he saw 70 imams giving 70 different classes at once. That's how Medina was. It was a university. That's how universities were. From dawn till dusk, 70 classes happening at one time. And sometimes there would be hundreds of ulama in there at coming and going through there. This masjid had the tabi'in and the tabi' tabi'in over there. Huge university. She chose for him a particular scholar. She deliberately chose him. She chose an imam by the name of Rabi'a ibn Abdul Rahman. I don't have time to go into his story. He's got a very fabulous story. Maybe one day we'll talk about him. But Rabi'a is the one who is known today, abbreviated as Rabi'a al-Ra'i. Rabi'a of opinion. He had really good opinions based on knowledge. Very good in deducing things. And you know, Rabi'a ibn Abdul Rahman is forgotten now. When someone earns a title, magnificence, they give him a magnificent name, and he no longer needs to say the surname and his lineage anymore. So now he's called Rabi'a al-Ra'i. Rabi'a al-Ra'i. Like Alexander the Great. There are many Alexanders, but when you say Alexander the Great, you know who we're talking about, yeah? So he was Rabi'a al-Ra'i, the garden of the best opinions. Imam Malik studied under him, and he, Rabi'a al-Ra'i, studied under what we call the seven fuqaha of Medina. I'm not going to go into that, but there were seven fuqaha were the third layer of scholars. There was the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the second layer were the Sahabas, and then the third layer were the tabi'in, who were called the seven fuqaha of Medina. And the fourth layer are the four imams. They sit in the fourth layer. This is called tabaqat al-ulama, or tabaqat al-fuqaha, the layers of scholars, known layers that are known among the scholars. I'm not going to go into Rabi'a too much, but Imam Malik did learn of how to deduce opinion based on knowledge. His mother advised him the following advice. I want everybody to listen to this advice. Very important. Fathers and especially mothers. And especially those who want to learn knowledge of Islam. The first thing his mother said to him was this. She looked him in the eye and said to him, son, I put you with this imam not just so you can learn his knowledge. Before you learn his knowledge, I want you to learn his adab, his morals and his character. There's a story about a Jewish man who was a very Jewish man, Jewish scribe. I forgot his name, but he learned knowledge in the same way. He used to go to his scholar in another land, And when he used to go to the scholar, and the scholar would say to him, Jewish scholar, say, which Torah, you know, which part of the Torah do you want to learn? He would say, I didn't come to learn the Torah, the information. I used to go to see how the scholar ties his shoes. You understand what I'm talking about? Students of knowledge learn the adab, the morals of the person. So these students used to watch every pattern of work that these scholars did. They looked at the way they looked, the way they sat, the way they moved, the way they dressed, the way they ate. Just like people look at celebrities. They didn't just learn the knowledge, ikhwan, brothers and sisters. Which is sad to see that in nowadays, we have two problems. People who learn knowledge, they separate themselves from good character and good morals. And their knowledge becomes debate and argumentation, which causes division. And there are even people of knowledge who forget the morals and character, and things like riya, showing off, become their target and position and so on. Then we have things like government scholars and the likes. And this is, wallahi, very sad. The very unique thing about these four imams and the imams of those times, different to the imams of today, is that those imams were self, they survived on their own income. And they were, and this made them very powerful. They did not survive on the state. They did not rely on any state or organization or masjid to provide them. They worked. Imam Malik, he had his own humble business of selling clothes. Imam Malik al-Asmahi from Yemen. He sold clothes and he survived on that. The other way he survived, he accepted gifts from the ruler. But he never took a person. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. Because the other imams never accepted gifts, but Imam Malik did. Very interesting. If we have time, inshallah, to talk about his philosophy. When he went with these scholars, he was a bit, as I said, naughty as a teenager. But his mischievousness, when he was naughty, I'll give you an example. He used to try and play a game to win the scholar all for himself. So he used to bring some dates and stuff, and he would assign some of his mates, his friends in the class, and he would say, I'll give you some dates to persuade the students to go back home today. So they'd go back home, and he'd be one with him or one or two people with this teacher, and so he'd have this teacher all for himself. And that's where Imam Malik began. He was a vessel of knowledge. He was so much so that he assisted, he was like, you know what we call a teacher's pet. That's what he was. And that wasn't looked down upon in those days. Nor was it looked down upon to someone saying, my mother influences me. My mother directs me. Today they use an ugly name called mummy's boy. And teacher's pet. These are names to deter people away from knowledge and learning. Al-Ummu Madrasa, as the poet says, إِذَا أَعْدَدْتَ أَعْدَدْتَ شَعْبًا طَيِّبَ الْأَعْرَاقِ. The mother is an educational institution. If you look after her, you have prepared a generation to come full of esteem and knowledge and charisma and everything, wisdom. So he was a teacher's pet, mummy's boy, if you like. I'm not afraid to say that. And he loved hadith, he loved his teachers. He used to stand outside and wait for his teachers in the heat of the sun. In Medina, it's not like here, you know, clouds, it was hot. And he used to endure. For example, one time he waited for his imam outside on a very hot rock. And he sat out there in the sun, not like, you know, today, no one has respect for the imam. They ask him left, right, and center, everyone overloads each other and overload the imam. No, he used to sit there, not even knock on his door. He'd wait for an hour, sometimes 2 hours, 3 hours in the heat of the sun, right in the middle of the dhuhr when everyone else was at home. And he'd wait for his imam. And one of his imams, Imam Ibn Hurmuz, which is going to talk about as a second imam, he never liked people to stop him and ask him questions except at the time of his dars. Because he had to organize his time, otherwise there will be mayhem. But Imam Malik didn't settle for that. He tried to always work his way around. So he'd wait on that rock, and when the Imam came out, he'd see him. And he'd rush after him very secretly. And the first thing he would do is he would say, As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The Imam has to say, wa alaykum as-salam. This is how he began his introduction. Now, first time, he's not going to ask him a question, just salams. So now his introduction's there. They'd go and pray the dhuhr, and after dhuhr, he'd follow him again. Say, As-salamu alaykum ya Imam. He's got a pen and the tablet. They didn't have papers like this. They had this rock stuff and bark and everything. And he would say, yeah, Imam, just about that masjid, about that hadith, can you just narrate that to me again? And about this masjid, he tried to get as many as he can from that Imam. And the Imam would have to answer him, you know, as he was walking by. So that's what he used to do. He excelled in and mastered in his knowledge. But his sister became worried that, you know, he used to stand a lot of hours in the sun. Sometimes he'd come back really sunburned. And his sister got worried, says, you know, Dad, you know, his older sister, my brother, he's always standing outside. He was only about like, we're talking about 12 years old, 13 years old, standing outside in the heat of the sun. Her father said to her, "Don't worry, daughter, he'll be all right. He is learning the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Let him endure." My brothers and sisters, not every alim, not every person has to study the way of the imams, the knowledge of fiqh. There are people who study other things, maths and engineering, astronomy. We all have the fundamentals of the deen, we all have to know. Not everyone has to be a faqih, okay? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this in the Quran, that not all people are destined to learn the same thing. We all help and assist each other. If it wasn't for example, Salman al-Farisi, in the Battle of Khandaq, the Muslims would have been destroyed. If he hadn't come with new ideas and innovations of building a trench. So if everyone was a faqih and a knowledgeable scholar in Islam, who will build the buildings and who will help us defend ourselves and all this technology and so on and so forth? My brothers and sisters in Islam, Imam Malik learnt of his first teacher, Rabi'atul Ra'i, for 7 whole years dedicated to him. After that, he started with the famous Imam Abdullah ibn Hurmuz. Abdullah ibn Hurmuz, and he stayed with him for 8 years. Abdullah ibn Hurmuz was an ex-servant, slave. And remember we mentioned last week that the majority of the scholars and the imams that taught our imams, they were migrants from other places and they converted to Islam, and they were mawalin, which means that they were servant slaves of tabi'in or sahabis. Ibn Hurmuz was one of those who was a freed slave. And he was the teacher of Imam Malik. Every Sahabi, he was a servant of a servant of a companion. And notice, my brothers and sisters, every Sahabi who had a servant, that servant became a master of knowledge of Islam. And Quraysh people, Quraysh from the family, from the lineage of the Prophet ﷺ, from his family, from that tribe of Quraysh, they're like of esteem, high esteem. They used to come and humble themselves, these Arab Quraysh, and sit in the circle classes of these mawali, these ex-slaves who were freed. So there is always humility and humbleness in knowledge. No one is better than another. So much so, brothers and sisters, I'm going to surprise you with something. Imam Malik, he got married to one wife. Again, sisters are happy about that because I mentioned Abu Hanifa last week. He was married to one wife and he had one son. Imam Malik had one wife and he had 3 sons and 1 daughter. His 3 sons were okay, they weren't really into knowledge. Especially one of his sons, the oldest one, he didn't like knowledge at all. He never listened to his father about coming to knowledge. He was kashish hanam. He took up the pigeon, herding pigeons as well. And he never liked knowledge. And Imam Malik used to say to his son, "Son, people are coming to me from Spain and Khurasan and coming from Africa and coming from all parts of the world, from China, on foot, traveling 4 months, 6 months journey to come and take the knowledge from your father. Just come away from the pigeons and listen to one of my circles." And his son just never did. He never had that gift, he never had that motivation. And this tells us that, not every child has the gift. And to take it easy, some parents, they want their children to be a particular thing. Don't worry. Not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put mawhiba, gifts in certain people which he didn't give to others. Just try and see which skill they best fit in and encourage him in that skill to exceed and excel in that. So long as that skill or that interest that he wants or she wants is not haram. So long as it's halal. Help them and motivate them, brothers and sisters. This is the will of Allah, otherwise we cannot be a community. Nuh alayhi salam's son was a kafir, What could he do? He was a prophet. Amazingly, out of his children, the one who became a scholar was his daughter. She was the one. Allah says in the Quran, يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثُ. He gives whoever he wants boys and he gives whoever he wants girls as daughters. لَا تَدْرِ أَيُّهُمَا أَقْرَبُ نَفْعًا. You will never know which one is more beneficial, the boy or the girl. Here it was the girl. She memorized the whole of the book of Imam Malik, which is called Al-Muwatta, and we'll come to that very quickly. Full of hadiths and narrations, and to the point where she used to correct her father's students. When her father was tired, he'd tell his daughter to test them. And whenever they made a mistake behind the door, she'd knock and correct them and tell her father they'd made a mistake in this narration, in this chain. So his daughter was the one. Amazing. His mother charted his future, and his daughter inherited. And Imam Malik, funny that I said inherited. I don't say inherited, she took it off him. But Imam Malik, when he saw his son, the one with pigeons, he used to look at him and say, Subhanallah, Allah who did not make knowledge an inheritance. You know, you can't just be born knowledgeable from a knowledgeable person. So Imam Malik had these famous teachers, Rabi'atul Ra'i and Imam Ibn Hurmuz. He graduated after 8 years from Ibn Hurmuz's school, and he became his friend, continued for 30 whole years. Ibn Hurmuz went over to Egypt and lived there the rest of his life, and Imam Malik kept on with correspondence between him and his friend the Imam until the Imam died. And Imam Malik never saw his friend after that, those 30 years. And he was sad that he didn't meet him after that. There is another Imam that he learnt of, his name was Imam Az-Zuhri. And this Imam Az-Zuhri, I'll tell you a really interesting story about Imam Malik with him. It was Eid time. And as students in Eid, they go and celebrate. Imam Malik, what's he doing in the morning after Salat al-Eid? He's going to the house of Imam Az-Zuhri. He hasn't even eaten yet. And he went with his books and his pen, and he waited outside the house of Imam Az-Zuhri. He was about 16 years old at that time. And he waited and waited and waited, and there was a servant of Imam Az-Zuhri. She saw Imam Malik outside, and she told Imam Az-Zuhri about him. She said, he asked her, who is it? And they used to call him the blonde boy. She said he was the blonde boy. And he said, let him in. So he came inside, and Imam Az-Zuhri thought that, you know, he's coming to eat the Eid food with him. So the Imam put in front of Malik, and Imam Malik looked at it and said, I don't want food. He said, what do you mean you don't? Then why are you here? He said, Tuhadithni. Teach me. Tell me hadith. And when you say hadith, we're talking about hadith or the chain of narrators and its men and everything. He said he sat down and he taught him 40 hadiths with their chain of narrations. And the Imam's writing it. Then the Imam said, Zidni, teach me more. And he said to him, Imam Az-Zuhri, go first and learn these and then come back, I'll teach you more. He said, I've learned them. He said, really? He said, yes. He said, give me it. Gave it to him, says, tell me. And he said them all with their chain of narrations without a single mistake at all, just by writing them once. When he did that, Imam Az-Zuhri looked at him and he said, Qum, stand up. A person like you shouldn't be sitting, should stand. Because the Imam should stand at honoring him. Stand before me. And he said to him, قُمْ فَأَنْتَ مِنْ أَوْعِيَةِ الْعِلْمِ. Stand, for you are one of the vessels of knowledge. You are one of the exceptions which Allah made. And that's what Imam Malik was. So as we said before, at the age of 21 years, he was qualified to give fatwa. New verdicts about new issues that had never happened before. It's very sad to see people today calling themselves muftis and bang, they're muftis all of a sudden. They learn a few hadiths, so they maybe graduate after learning a couple of years, or even graduate muftis. They can give new verdicts of new issues, and we have this problem, unfortunately. Some people don't even know Arabic language yet, and they're ready to give fatwas very quickly. My brothers and sisters in Islam, I'm going to cut a few things. I can't really talk about everything, although there are many interesting things. But what I would like to say is Imam Malik was really qualified and witnessed by many imams as one of the greatest. Imam Shafi'i, for example, said about him, if it wasn't for Sufyan ibn Uyayna, who was one of the close student friends of Imam Malik, they studied together. And if it wasn't for Imam Malik, knowledge in Hijaz, which is the Arab Peninsula, would cease in Medina. That's what Imam Shafi'i said about him. The special characteristic between Imam Malik and Imam Abu Hanifa was that Abu Hanifa's students were mostly people of Iraq, Kufa, Basra, and those areas. Imam Malik's students came from all over the world. Do you know why? Not because we're saying Imam Malik is better than Abu Hanifa. No, no, no. Imam Malik was in Medina. And people who went to Hajj and Umrah from all over the world passed through Medina, the grave of the Prophet ﷺ, as we see today. So people of the world went to Mecca and Medina. So it was coincidental this way that Imam Malik became more popular throughout the world in his time and quicker than Imam Abu Hanifa. Even though Imam Abu Hanifa later on became more popular till today. Till today he's actually more famous and popular in his madhab. But Imam Malik spread very quickly and much more rapidly throughout the world than Imam Abu Hanifa in his time because of that. The third teacher of Imam Malik was a man by the name of Nafi' al-Daylami. He was they call him Mawla ibn Umar. He was the ex-slave of Abdullah, the son of Umar radiallahu anhuma. And Abdullah ibn Umar, he taught this man Nafi', a very important figure in our scholars of history of scholars. And he freed him. And Imam Nafi' was one of the teachers, the third teacher of Imam Malik. Imam Malik was one of those who narrated hadith. Do you know what I'm talking about? When you read a hadith, there's something called the sanad, which is the text, the nas, which means the text, and the sanad, which is the chain of narration. You know, not like I say, you know, on the authority of Abu Hurairah, yada yada yada, and Imam Muslim collected it. No. When these people read hadith, if you read their books, like if you go to Tafsir ibn Kathir, for example, I used to read it when I was younger, and I say, man, I just want to know the hadith. I read the whole page, sometimes, wallahi, half a page, so-and-so who heard so-and-so, but this man maybe didn't hear it from this man, and it's said about this man that maybe he didn't reach this man, but I say that he did because of this, to reach this man. And finally, the hadith comes in one sentence. The whole page, one sentence. And then they put the comments of the scholars about the strength of this hadith. This is when these scholars said hadith, this is how they said it. They didn't just say what I'm saying. Prophet ﷺ said, "Innama al-amalu bin-niyyat," all actions are judged by intentions and so on. No, not like that. They came and they started. Narrated by so-and-so and so-and-so and this and that and that. So this is when we're talking about knowledge here. Imam Malik had something very significant that is known till today. He had something called the golden chain. As-silsilat al-dhahabiyya. Any hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that had the following chain, from Malik, who heard it from Nafi', who heard it from Ibn Umar, who heard it from the Prophet ﷺ, if you see that chain before any hadith, Malik, heard it from Nafi', heard it from Ibn Umar, who heard it from the Prophet ﷺ, the scholars unanimously say this is the strongest chain of narration to exist in any form of hadith. They call it the golden chain. And Imam Malik narrated, as far as I can remember, subhanAllah, he narrated many hadiths that we go by today. Hundreds of hadiths that we go by today. His fourth teacher was Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri. He was a great tabi'i. He's the one that he went to his house on Eid, as we said before. His fifth teacher was Ja'far al-Sadiq. Ever heard of him? Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. Even though some of his followers today misinterpret his teachings and they say things about him that are not true. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq was a teacher and a friend of Imam Abu Hanifa. And there is a school of thought called the Ja'fari Madhab. And Imam Ja'far narrated 9 hadiths that are mentioned in the book of Imam Malik al-Muwatta. Ja'far radiallahu anhu was the grandson of Ali radiallahu anhu. And he was a very important figure who was the teacher of Imam Malik. I just want to mention one of Imam Ja'far's very famous quotes. I think it's very beneficial to us. It's about Qada and Qadar, which Imam Malik also adopted. Listen to this. For those of you who talk about, you know, who worry about the future and destiny, what Allah has written for you and the unknown. He said, "Inna Allah ta'ala arada bina shay'an wa arada minna shay'an." Very simple terms. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined for us things, and He made them unknown. And He wanted from us things. فَمَا أَرَادَهُ بِنَا طَوَاهُ عَنَّا. What He destined us for, He made it unknown to us. وَمَا أَرَادَهُ مِنَّا أَظْهَرَهُ لَنَا. And what He wanted from us, He showed it to us. So why do you have to sit there and thinking of the future? The unknown, brothers and sisters. Don't think of the unknown. Don't worry about the unknown and ask questions of the unknown. think and worry about what you have that is known and work with it. Imam Malik, my brothers and sisters, he was a mujtahid, as we said. I want to talk a little bit about his personality a little bit more. I said that he was tall, handsome, good looking. He dressed in the most beautiful of dressing. I'm talking about he dressed in all the brands. He used to buy deliberately brands from Yemen and Khurasan and different places to wear them. Different brands. You might be thinking now, what's this? He's very unique in that way. He differed from all the scholars, the four imams in this thing. He loved to dress very pleasantly, eloquently and beautifully. Designer clothes. It says that one of his garments, one of his thobes, was worth 500 dinars. That's a lot of money in those days. That's a tremendous amount of money in those days. And he wore a ring. It was a silver ring and it had a black stone on this ring which said, and was written on this ring, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil. Enough for me is Allah, and what a beautiful one to rely upon. He had that written on his silver ring. He always bathed in the morning. He always smelt the best. Beautiful perfume. Imam Malik was known for that. And he had an opinion, a philosophy slightly different to those who we call Zuhad, ascetics. This is mostly known in Sufism, attributed to Sufism. Although Sufism did not exist officially at the time of Imam Malik, it actually was, and some people might disagree with me, but historically I can prove it, hundreds, maybe a couple of hundred years after these Imams did Sufism become an official way. But the actions of what they call Sufism today, such as asceticism, meaning to abstain from the luxuries of the world, was practiced. It was practiced by Al-Hasan al-Basri, was practiced by Imam Abu Hanifa, even Imam Malik in a certain way, and even by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sufism was actually practiced in the West as well, way before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, but in a more complex way. So Sufism came from the West actually. When they came and visited and invaded our lands hundreds of years later, and these ideas came and crept into us and we took some of their ideas. Now some of the Sufis' ideas is excellent, mashallah, but some of the stuff that came from Greek theology, especially in Aqidah, such as the visiting of the graves and seeking saints' names and seeking their protection and their cure, is shirk wal-iyadu billah. And this came unfortunately from Greek philosophy and the rest. But Imam Malik, he was a Zahid, he was an ascetic. But how? His philosophy was opposite to the others. He said, Zuhud is on the inside, in the heart, not outward appearance. So much so that he used to have a soft handkerchief. He used to bring it with him. And when they asked him, why do you have a soft handkerchief, Imam? He says, because when he made sujood on the rocks of Medina, you know, it was a harsh earth, not like today, beautiful carpet. People used to get the sign here on their forehead for sujood very quickly. And he realized that people were showing this off. People get it and they weren't really, they didn't have the esteem of that. And they called this as a abid. He was a person, a worshipper, you know, away from the world. He didn't want that on his head. And he used to say, so that people don't get tricked and look at this, and just by looking at this sign saying, there goes a abid, there goes a great worshipper, a saint. He wanted to break that stereotype. And we see today that it's sort of revered. It's this, that when people have a mark here, we say, oh, you know, it's a great ibid. Some people, I remember in Lebanon when I was there, the older generation, when they go down to sujood, you could hear them hitting their head hard on the ground. And they used to, somebody, I could watch them as a child, they used to rub their heads, I could see from sujood. And subhanAllah, I used to look at them and think, they're not really good examples of deen outside. And they used to say language that wasn't appropriate and do things. So it's not about this and it's not about that. And Imam Malik wanted to break that stereotype. He was a man of a very strong personality. You know what I'm talking about? You know when some people, they do things to please people, right? And they know that it's slightly wrong, or they would hide the truth. Imam Malik was not like that. It was exactly the opposite of that. He was a man that he used to say, based on the Dalil, and he would say his opinion, if people liked it, they liked it. If they don't like it, bad luck, go away. That was his attitude. In his circles, if anybody spoke while he is speaking, that would be forbidden. Opposite to Abu Hanifa's circles, he used to encourage his students to discuss and debate. You see people talking on top of each other. He's like the modern day approach. And really it had to be like that for Abu Hanifa, because he lived in Kufa where many ideologies were brought in. So he had to have discussion. As for Imam Malik, who lived in Medina, the knowledge in Medina was different. it was quite strict and straightforward. And these ideologies of Khawarij and Mu'tazila and Greek philosophy and Aristotle's beliefs and stuff, they weren't in Medina. So Imam Malik was not interested in all those ideologies. Anyone who asked them, does Allah have a hand? Where is He? In which face is He directed? And all those thoughts, he never attempted to even answer them except in one way. Brief answers that made them be quiet, take it as it is and walk away. And I'll tell you a little story. One time he's sitting in his circles and a man entered. And he asked a question. He said, "Ya Imam, I have a question. Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, the most merciful rose above his throne. What does rose above his throne mean? Istawa." Imam Malik, the student, says he put his head down and they could see sweat coming down his forehead out of anger. He was angry. Then he looked up and he said, "Al-istiwa'u ma'loom." Istiwa is not unknown to us. We know in Arabic what istiwa is: aboveness, highness, above everything. Wal-kayfu majhool. But how is unknown. I don't know how above. It's not like our aboveness. But Allah is above, is not below. وَالسُّؤَالُ عَنْهُ بِدْعَةً. And asking this question is an innovation. And then he looked at him and he said to his students, أَخْرِجُوهُ. Get him out. They carried him out of the masjid quickly. And he said, وَلَا أَظُنُّكَ إِلَّا فَتَّانَ أَوْ مُبْتَدِعَ. I don't see you except an innovator or a mischievous person who wants to cause fitna. That's how we dealt with these issues. In his circles, he never allowed someone, he didn't like people asking him, "What's your dalil?" I know that people think, "What's this? Not asking me what's the dalil?" This was Imam Malik's philosophy. I'll tell you why. This man was the one who, all around the world, people in Morocco, for example, they used to send their students to him in Africa when they had a question. None of the scholars of those countries knew it, and they would say, "Imam Malik is the most knowledgeable Imam in the world. There isn't an Imam on the face of the earth more knowledgeable than him." Everybody said this. He was it. He was the man. And found, and truly, even his teachers liked to discuss with him. He was the man. And when they were asked, "What's your dalil on complex issues?" He didn't like it because they're asking him things which they don't understand themselves. And there's a story, a joke, a humorous story which I heard from one of the speakers. He said, actually read it as well, that one particular imam said a hadith. Abu Huraira said this. And the students asked him, "Imam, what's the chain of narration?" He said, "You want to know the chain of narration?" They're not muhaddithin. They don't know hadith. "What's the chain of narration?" He said, "Okay, if you want to know the chain of narration, an Ahmad, an Muhammad, an Abdul Rahman, an he gave him chain of narration. Ahmad said, heard from Muhammad, heard from..." And they all wrote it down. And he said, "Are you satisfied?" They said, "Yes." Said, "Does anyone know who these narrators are?" And some of them started to guess. "Yeah, I know this person." They're guessing, right? And he said, "You're all wrong. That Ahmad is the neighbor next door to my house, and the second one is the baker down the road." And he just gave him any names. Just to go to show that imams know, when you want to ask dalil, you got to understand what dalil. You have to be at that caliber of that level of dalil. We can ask certain dalil. We can look at an imam and say, "Imam, you're a trustworthy person. This is in Muslim, you say. Can I look it up, the reference?" Say, "Yes, it's in Muslim." And khala, that's it. You sit there asking all the detail as if, mashallah, you're a scholar now. How, what would you understand about understanding dalil? Black and white. We've got black and white, rigid ways. My brothers and sisters in Islam, Imam Malik loved bananas. He loved eating bananas. Seriously. And he had a balanced diet. He loved a healthy diet. He was a man, contrary to the others, ate meat every day. Because he used to say, when he was asked, "Why do you eat meat every day?" He said, "Because it provides me strength in knowledge and I need it for the sake of Allah." He also ate a lot of fruit, again, for the vitamins and minerals. He loved bananas because he said, it is mentioned in the Quran, وَطَلْحٍ مَنْضُودٍ, it is the fruit of Jannah. And the fact that it's nice and it's smooth, he liked it. So every day I ate bananas, which struck me the other day. I was thinking, subhanAllah, Imam Malik liked bananas. And what was interesting is that his madhab, his school of thought, it first started in Africa. And I heard, I was at a nikah the other day and there were Somalians. And they love to eat with their food, any food, bananas. Meat, I don't know your food, what it's called, all every type, bananas. They eat their food, they eat the meat with the bananas, the rice with the bananas. Am I wrong? That's right. And I wondered if Imam Malik's, his character of liking bananas also went there, and that's how bananas began with their food. So Imam Malik was of that type. And it just goes to show that, brothers and sisters, you know, when people talk about you're not allowed to be wealthy, you're not allowed to be rich, you're not allowed to wear nice clothing, where did you get this from? And Imam Malik used to use two reasons. He said, number one, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يُرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ. Allah loves to see the effect of His blessings on His servant. He also, another reason, I want to tell you something. Where he used to sit was the same spot where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to sit and teach. It was the same spot where Umar radiallahu anhu, the Khalifa, sat and taught. And guess this, he never in his life narrated a single hadith while standing. If he ever wanted to narrate a hadith, just say a hadith. We should listen to me carefully, brothers and sisters, very important. About those who throw their words very quickly, especially on the internet behind usernames, and no one knows who they are. Imam Malik, before he ever said one hadith, he'd go and have a shower, or he'd make wudu, then he'd pray two rak'ahs, then he'd wear the best of clothing, put on the best of perfume, enter the masjid quietly, would not say a word until serenity and peace befell him. Wallahi, I'm not exaggerating. This is what his students say. He went to the seat of where the Prophet ﷺ used to sit, and he sat there. Then he looked up at his students, and he spoke the hadith with its narration. That's how Imam Malik narrated hadith. We're not talking about these scholars, these imams. You know what type of people we're talking about? Time is up, I know. I'll finish it here, subhanAllah. Maybe next week we'll finish the rest of it. I'll finish it with this. When we talk about these imams, brothers and sisters, even though Imam Malik, he had a very humble home, but very, very neat. I don't think he was very wealthy. He rented his house all his life. He lived in rent. And the house he rented, was, guess who it belonged to? It belonged to someone who bought it from someone who bought it from one of the Sahabas of the Prophet ﷺ. It was the house of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. That's the house he lived in. It was so neat, so decorated, the best of furniture, but he rented this house, and he was not very wealthy. As I said, at one stage, he was a bit tight on money. When I say tight, he preserved it for his education and for his students. That's how the scholars, they looked after their students. It was so much so that he one time had to sell the wood in the ceiling of his house to make ends meet. So you stay without a roof for a little while in the cause of education and knowledge. But the most important thing I want to say to you, brothers and sisters, again, as we started the theme, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. The ones who truly fear Allah and are righteous are the scholars. This man, as like Abu Hanifa and the rest, was full of something called wara. Wara, which means that they abstained from even the smallest halal things, fearing that it may lead them to haram. And he was... And we're talking about, these people never knew alcohol, never knew cheating, never knew lying, never knew gambling, never knew backbiting, never knew jealousy, never knew envy, never knew even looking at someone hurting their feeling in any way. This is their lifestyle. And they were truly like angels in every sense, every name, of, in every sense of the word. They were truly like angels walking the earth. This is who we are talking about. I ended here, inshallah. And just last thing I want to say about his house, so that we don't have to repeat it next week. Apart from his furniture inside, his door, he had a sign on his door entrance which said the following ayah: وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ. And when you enter your garden, your Jannah, say مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ, oh what God will. So for those who say that I shouldn't hang up ayat, inshallah, it is okay, there's nothing wrong with it. Imam Malik had it as a reminder for people who entered. But people could read it. It wasn't jumbled up. So that's what he had at the entrance. I finish here, inshallah, with this great Imam Malik. And inshallah, next week we will continue it and move on to Imam al-Shafi'i and then Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وآخر دعوانا عن الحمد لله.
صلي على محمد رسول الله اللهم صلي على محمد نبي الله اللهم صل على محمد رسول الله اللهم صل على of praising Allah, to glorify Allah. O mountains of Mecca, what can you tell of the day that stones from the sky fell, destroying an army determined to break the house of Allah that Abraham built. O mountains of Mecca, how was the dawn on the day that my prophet Muhammad was born? How did it feel knowing he was to be the last and most beloved of all? Rasul of Allah, Nabi of Allah. O mountains of Mecca, you were there when the Prophet Muhammad climbed down in despair. Engraved in his heart were the words of his Lord to all of mankind. This was his call: La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. O people, praise only Allah, glorify Allah. O mountains of Mecca, how did you mourn on the day that the beloved returned to his Lord? And up till the last breath escaped from his lips, he prayed that his Ummah would find success. O mountains of Mecca, how will it feel when the earth shall quake and tremble with fear, and we shall be gathered together to stand in the court of Allah with our deeds at hand? Oh, how we pray that on that day we'll be with those to whom Allah will say, peace be with you, I am pleased with you. O mountains of Mecca, bear witness that I to the oneness of Allah do I testify. For all that he's given me, how can I deny? My purpose in life should be only to cry, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, Muhammad is his messenger. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, Muhammad is his messenger.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. My brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We meet again in yet another dars circle about another giant from the giants of the scholars of Islam. He is the second Imam of the great four Imams, the founders of the four famous schools of thought, Madhahib. We've already spoken about Imam Abu Hanifa, and last week we began speaking about the second Imam after him, Imam Malik ibn Anas rahmatullah alayhim ajma'in. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah. And today inshaAllah we will continue the second part about Imam Malik, as last week we weren't able to complete his whole life story. And to be honest, one or two lectures is not really enough. We will do no justice speaking about these great four Imams at all. But it is, in a nutshell, for you to just sort of grab a general picture, a general feeling, as though you are sitting with them, a general feeling of what type of people they were, how they thought, how their lifestyle was, how did they develop these schools of thought. But the most important thing about learning about these great scholars is their character, their etiquettes in seeking knowledge, and how they were surrounded by people who learned from them their character before their knowledge, what kind of people they were as role models. They are our examples in life. Imam Malik, the man of aura, as we said, the man whom when you looked at him you cannot help yourself but give him respect. Not only because of his knowledge, extra to that were the features which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. He was a tall man, wide chested, broad chested. He looked strong. But the difference between him and the rest of the residents of Medina was his unusual features of being very white, very close to blonde, was basically blonde, and colored eyes. He looked like a Westerner, even though his origin was from Yemen and he lived in Medina. He really stood out. We finished off last week about Imam Malik's, we were beginning to talk about his character as a teacher and as a seeker of knowledge. And we spoke about how he became into the school and the circle of education, and where he was inspired from. It was his mother and his father, but mostly his mother, who basically chartered his life into the world of great fiqh jurisprudence. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in the ayah which completes by saying, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Allah tells us in the Quran that He sent people, prophets and people after them. He recites the verses, or brings to them the verses of the Quran, and He purifies their character. And He teaches them the Quran, and teaches them the Kitab, the scripture, and He teaches them the wisdom. So with every ayah that speaks about knowledge in relation to these people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala usually accompanies a second characteristic which is simultaneous to knowledge, and that is tazkiyah, which is purification, character, etiquettes, manners, respect, You cannot be a knowledgeable person or a student of knowledge if you don't first have the character and respect. And let me remind you what the mother of Imam Malik said to him when she took him to the Masjid al-Nabawi in Medina to learn of the great teacher Rabi'ah ibn Abd al-Rahman, Rabi'ah al-Ra'i, and the likes of him. She said to him, "Son, before you learn the ilm, the knowledge of these imams, I want you to learn the character and etiquettes of these imams. Learn how they sit, how they eat, how they stand, how they look at people, the eye movements, the way they, in other words, the way they tie their shoelaces. Learn these things from them before you learn the knowledge. A person without character but has knowledge is like a child with weapons. Is like a child with weapons. They'll cause destruction." And there is a saying among the Turkish culture, when Imam said this to me, he says, "We have a saying that if you're half a doctor, you'll kill people. And if you are half a alim, half a scholar, you'll lead people astray." And that made a lot of sense to me, mashallah. Allah says in the Quran, "Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu lima taquluna ma la taf'alun." O you who believe, why do you say that which yourselves do not do? So among the great things which the scholars had to monitor was that they applied what they taught. And you're going to see today, inshallah, the application of this Imam Malik, of what he taught, and what all the Imams feared. Aisha radiallahu anha says about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when she was asked about him, she said, "Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an." His character was the Qur'an itself. So we don't want to live a life of double personalities and we are driven by our desires. These were not these great imams. I mentioned that Imam Malik's fiqh, his way of thinking, was a little bit different to Imam Abu Hanifa. In fact, very different to all the imams. Imam Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmad. He differed a little bit in the sense he didn't like to dwell into areas of controversial issues in Aqidah. And he didn't like to dwell into areas of ideological differences, such as what used to happen in Kufa with Imam Abu Hanifa, with the Mu'tazila and the Khawarij, philosophies of Greek theology and Aristotle's beliefs, such as saying today, modernist views, all those different views. He didn't dwell into them. In fact, he didn't need to do that because he was living in Medina. And in Medina, till today, to a certain limit, these ideologies are not too many in there as much as they are around the world. The Western influence, the Western ideologies are not entrenched in there. You can still see the tradition there. Imam Malik was a traditional man. He taught according to Amal Ahl al-Madinah, the actions and practices of the people of Medina. He was to look at the companions who lived in Medina, and his laws and school of thought revolves a lot around them, as you will see today, inshallah. We mentioned that a man entered once into his circle, and he said to him, "Ya Imam." And one of his students by the name of Yahya ibn Yahya, he used to report a lot about Imam Malik, Yahya ibn Yahya, remember that name. He says, "A man entered into our circle one day and he asked the Imam a question. He said, 'Ya Imam, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa,' the most merciful rose above his throne." That's literally what it says in the Quran. He asked, "Kayfa istawa?" How did Allah rise? Imam Malik put his head down and the students could see him sweating. Sweating out of anger. He was angry at that question, asking about the self of Allah, Allah Himself, to describe how He does things. This is unimaginable. This is laysa kamithlihi shay. There is nothing like unto Allah. So to merely ask the question, how does Allah rise, is disbelief. So Imam Malik looked up and he said to him, "Al-istiwa'u ma'lum." The word istiwa is not unknown to us. We know what it is on face value. to rise above, to be above something, not to be below. والكيف مجهول. Its features, how Allah does istiwa, is unknown to us. والإيمان به واجب. Believing in that Allah is above everything is istiwa, is a must. We have to believe in this. We can't deny that Allah spoke like this about Himself. والسؤال عنه بدعة. Questioning about the nature of Allah's actions and His attributes is a bid'ah, it's an innovation. None of the companions nor any of the prophets ever dwelled into the nature of Allah's attributes. How? Because He is nothing like us. You will never reach the answer to that. He's beyond our imagination, beyond our capabilities. Then He said, أخرجوه, get him out of here with force. Get him out. And basically they drove him out like the police do, and he said, وَلَا أَظُنُّهُ إِلَّا فَتَّانًا وَلَا أَظُنُّكَ إِلَّا مُبْتَدِعُ فَتَّانًا. I don't assume you except to be one of a fitna maker or an innovator. So he never liked to dwell into these areas. Brothers and sisters, today we want to continue about also the reason why he liked to avoid, the reason why he chose a bit of niceness in his appearance and his clothing. Some people may think that he was a luxurious person, whereas he wasn't. You can misunderstand that. We mentioned last week that he liked to wear beautiful clothing, the best of clothing. In fact, he liked spending if whatever he could on clothing that was very presentable, and he refused to sit on the chair or on the in the place where the Prophet ﷺ used to sit, in the very same place. And when Umar radiallahu anhu sat in the Masjid al-Nabawi in the Rawda Sharifa, without being absolutely presentable, would have bathed beforehand, wear his best of clothing and fill himself with perfume and perfume, and then he would sit, you'd see the serenity on his face, he would look up to you, up at you, and then he would begin. This is the way Imam Malik's personality in how he taught hadith to the people. And we mentioned that before he taught a new hadith, he's about to narrate a new hadith to the students to teach them. With its narrations, he would make wudu first, pray two rak'ah, not speak to anyone, walk and sit on the chair, and then he would speak to the people of the hadith. That's how he would address them with the hadith. My brothers and sisters, Imam Malik learnt of, as we said, Rabi'atul Ra'i, great teacher. And he's called Rabi'ah ibn Abdul Rahman, but he's nicknamed Rabi'atul Ra'i, which means the garden of opinions. Now scholars do give opinions. When we say opinions, it's different to the way the West speaks about opinions. Opinions in among the scholars are based on evidence and proof that originates from the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Opinions in the West talk from their whims and desires. There is no basis except whims and desires. And that's why you get things like homosexuality and atheism, right? And people who come with very bizarre things where right seems wrong and the wrong seems right in any way they want. This is opinion. Opinion of man is very dangerous if it's not based on evidence and proof that comes from a legitimate source. And our source is from the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah left this deen with some flexibility in it because of the changing times. But the foundations He gave us in the Quran and Sunnah, there is nothing left out that we cannot use to solve any problem that we have in any given society. But the people who do this, who bring these solutions to us, are the scholars. Are the scholars. They are the inheritors of the prophets. Otherwise, we would have never had scholars. We don't need scholars then. We're just enough with the prophets and that's it. But Allah made this deen in a way that you can use its foundations for any changing society. And because of this, brothers and sisters, expect to have differing opinions. That's fine. Differences of opinions among scholars and people is fine. We have to learn to accept that. You cannot change it. And everyone who tried to change it, it's been there for more than 1,400 years. Even among the Sahabas, they differed. Umar ibn al-Khattab and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhuma. They differed on almost every single issue. And when we say differed, we're talking about branches of the deen, not something that's quite clear. And I gave some examples last week. For example, when I give an udhiyah, should I give it to my relatives who are poor, or is it better to give to strangers who are poor? Things like that, which don't really affect your iman or your deen, and it shouldn't. It shouldn't play a role. Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhum, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to them, If you ever agree on a matter, then automatically I agree. You don't even have to come and consult me. That's how much they differed, Abu Bakr and Umar. If you ever agree on something, just go ahead and do it. Don't even consult me, because I know it has to be right for both of you to agree. That's how much they differed. But they loved each other. They died for each other. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he became the Khalifa after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he used to say, لَقَدْ أَتْعَبْتَ مَنْ جَاءَ بَعْدَكَ يَا أَبَا بَكْرِ. You have truly exhausted those who came after you. Meaning himself, I'm trying to be like you and I can't even reach your status. Even though they differed. And in a lot of times, Rasulullah ﷺ agreed with Umar, and a lot of times he agreed with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Even a lot of ayat came down in favor of Umar radiallahu anhu, such as the ayah of hijab. Yeah, Umar radiallahu anhu is the one who instigated it. So there's nothing wrong with difference of opinion, so long as you base it on dalil, and so long as it doesn't cause the division. Doesn't, based on whims and desires, nationality, culture, race, gender, you know, people who are rich or for whatever, popularity. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that, inshallah, very soon, in examples of Imam Malik. Imam Malik's fiqh was in the following way. His sources were as follows. These are the sources he used. Like every other scholar, including Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik first looked at the Qur'an for solutions. If there was no clear-cut solution in the Qur'an, then he would look second into the Sunnah, the ways of the Prophet ﷺ, the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ. Is there anything in the Hadith? Is there anything in his actions? If there was nothing clear-cut, and now we're coming down to very detailed, minute information now about the deen. It has to be something quite special that has occurred. He would look into the opinions of the Sahabas. What did the Sahabas of the Prophet ﷺ consider? He would look into their differing opinions. Then if he couldn't find a clear-cut solution from the opinions of the Sahaba, he would then look at something called al-ijma', consensus of the scholars. Consensus of the companions and consensus of the scholars, the great scholars that existed. And up to here, all the four imams still followed up to this stage. Now here was where Imam Malik differed. He looked at something which the other imams actually didn't agree with him about. Including one of his very close colleagues who studied with him. His name was Al-Layth ibn Sa'd, which some scholars consider Al-Layth, his contemporary, his, the student that studied with him, his best friend, to be even more knowledgeable than Imam Malik. Al-Layth ibn Sa'd used to differ on this. What was it? Imam Malik used to use the practices of the people of Medina, meaning he would look at their practices and how they acted, and he would say, act like them. And there were more than 120,000 companions in Medina that lived by the time Imam Malik came around. So he used to use their practices to bring out rulings. Imam Layth ibn Sa'd used to write letters to him saying, yeah, Imam, you are right to use these great Sahabas of Medina. That's good. We don't see ourselves any better than them. However, not 200 years later, there are customs involved. Like these people of Medina, they had Arab customs, which they still kept, something called Urf, which is acceptable by us today. Traditions of your culture, which doesn't go against Islam. You can't take everything of the practice of the people of Medina. This was the opinion of his friend Al-Layth. And Imam Malik respected his opinion, but he stuck to his own, believing that this is the right one. If he couldn't find it among the people of Medina, he went to something which Imam Abu Hanifa used, and that is Qiyas. To come to a ruling by comparison. He'd look at a ruling that's similar to it and say, okay, we'll say that it's like this. We'll practice it like this. For example, cigarettes. Scholars used qiyas today about smoking cigarettes. A few years back, the scholars used to say that smoking cigarettes is makruh. It's just disliked. But when they found out the effects of smoking and tobacco and how bad it is, they said it's akin, it's the same as drugs, it's the same as alcohol, same as intoxicants, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned. So they say, based on this, by comparison, we conclude that cigarettes and tobacco is haram, like the way drugs are, or alcohol is haram. Maybe not as bad as alcohol, but by the same, in the same sort of category, on a, to a lesser extent. This is called qiyas, comparison. Imam Malik also looked at a very unique way, and this is where he really differed, something full of flexibility. In his madhab, you will find three things that the other imams didn't practice too much, but they took it to a certain extent. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal didn't take any of it except very little. One of it was called al-istihsan, which means the better of two fiqh matters. If he's got two fiqh matters, he'll take the easier one or the better one. So two possible solutions, he'll take the easier one. And the second thing he used to follow was sadd al-dhara'i, which means something lawful or unlawful depending on what it will lead to. For example, if it leads to destruction, eliminate it. So if something is normally halal, I'll give an example. Ibn al-Qayyim used it once. I'm not going to dwell too much into it because we haven't got much time. But Imam Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahmatullah alayh, when he was in prison, he sent a ruling that selling grapes is haram. I'm just explaining this ruling. He went by Imam Malik's method over here, sadd al-dhara'i, to prevent halal things which will lead to haram. He prevented the selling of grapes. And one man who was an official, he got angry at him and he caused him to spend more time in prison because he used to sell grapes and he made his business go down. So he asked him, why did you do that? The Imam Ibn al-Qayyim said to him, Ya Akhi, I only said it from the door of sadd al-dhara'i to prevent harm. What was happening was that he was selling it to people who were becoming well known and popular in squeezing it and making alcohol. And people were selling alcohol in the black market, and it was becoming on an increase. So he prevented the grapes for a little while. And this is called sadd al-dhara'i. Thirdly, and also something haram can become slightly looked sort of surpassed in order to stop something greater haram than that. And thirdly, al-masalih al-mursala, the benefits of the public. If something may lead to the harm of the public or community, even if it was something halal, even if it was something ordered, then you should stop it. An example of that is Umar radiallahu anhu, when he stopped the severing of the hand for thieves, people who stole. Why? Because there was a drought and there were lots of poverty. So he stopped or suspended the severing of the hand for a little while and said, no, we can't go to that extreme, it's unfair, it's not just. You can't just do that. So there was a penalty, maybe to pay something or to be imprisoned or forgiven, depending on the situation. And this is al-masalih al-mursala, to look at the benefits of the people at large. And Imam Malik used this to a great extent. And that's why a lot of imams, they look at the school of thought of Imam Malik. Even though Imam Malik in himself was actually quite traditional, quite rigid, being in Medina. Even till today, you go to Mecca and Medina, we still have that view. They're quite rigid, you know, traditional in one way. And that's why sometimes the fatwas for the West are not very suitable sometimes. I say this with understanding, sincerity, inshallah. But Imam Malik's madhab was actually the most flexible because of these three. The other imams differed about that. They didn't really agree on it. Maybe Abu Hanifa to a certain extent. Now I'll go on to something about the way he respected his seniors and his scholars. There is a story about Imam Malik when he was with two of his teachers. One of them was Rabi'at al-Ra'i, the garden of great opinions, and the other was Ibn al-Zuhri. Imam Malik was still, he was the junior of them, but he had reached the level of great scholar. He was giving fatwas, as we said, at the age of 21. People from around the world come to him, to Medina, to learn of him at the age of 21. Today, 21-year-olds, what are they doing? Still racing on the street on their pee plates, trying to beat, other pee platers, girls and stuff, and trying to steal, I call them lollipop suckers, still like children, still sucking their lollipop at 21. So, I don't mean to offend anybody, but you know what I mean. 21-year-olds, still, they think that they're still little kids, when these imams are 21 and giving great fatwas. So Imam Zuhri and Rabi'at Ra'i were sitting there, Imam Malik was there. And we're talking about, they're older than him by about 40 years here. So Rabi'at Ra'i and Imam Zuhri, Ibn Zuhri, they differed on an opinion, on an issue. So they looked at Imam Malik, and Rabi'a was the main teacher of Imam Malik. He's the main teacher before Ibn Zuhri. So they asked him, what do you think? Yeah, Imam Malik, he was quiet. He said, "What do you think, Ibn Zuhri?" I asked him, "What do you think?" And the reply of Imam Malik was, "The master has answered." The master has answered, meaning Rabi'a, his teacher has answered. Then Imam Zuhri said to him, "Wallahi, we won't leave until you give us an answer. We insist." So Imam Malik then gave his answer, and it happened to be the exact opposite answer of his teacher, Rabi'a. Exact opposite. Ibn Zuhri looked at him and he said, "I agree with you." And they walked away respectfully. The point, how he showed total respect to his teacher and master. I have a lesson to the children and their parents. Do you show respect to your parents even when you know that your parents are wrong and you're right? They have a wrong opinion. How many children today are quick to jump at the parents to make them feel embarrassed about their wrong opinion? This is not the way to advise. And between brothers and sisters, between us, you want to advise someone? I think it was Imam Malik or Imam Shafi'i, quote him inshallah next week, who said, if you want to advise someone, then don't advise them in public. Because if you advise them in public, then you have humiliated them. It defeats the purpose of the advice. An-nasiha, amam an-nas fadiha. Advice in front of people is an exposure, is a humiliation. So you've got to avoid that stuff. So even when a person is wrong, address it in a proper way. And next week we're going to give an example of one of the students of Imam Shafi'i, how he advised his teacher on a matter when he waited for all the people to leave. But that's inshallah next week. Brothers and sisters, we mentioned that Imam Malik had some sources of income. And there were two main sources of income. But first of all, I'd like to mention he was never a government scholar. Because some people think that. Nor did any of these imams ever rely on an organization or masjid or government to supply them with any income. They always had their own trade and their own skill which they earned from. And that's what made them very powerful. So they always spoke the truth even in front of powerful leaders. Now Malik had two pieces of income. One of them was from three. One of them was from his business, he sold clothing. The other one was from his friend, Layth ibn Sa'd. He was actually quite wealthy, who lived in Egypt, and he used to send him wealth every now and then. The third sort of source of income was actually from the Khalifa. He never accepted anything from anyone else except the Khalifa and only the Khalifa. And he never had a post or a position with the government. He always refused it like the rest of the imams. Never wanted to. And he was one of those also like Imam Abu Hanifa who refused to be a judge. All these scholars refused to be a judge because they didn't want to be gathered on the day of judgment with the rest of the rulers of the world. Who are they going to be gathered with? How many corrupt rulers? You don't want to be gathered on the day of judgment with these rulers. You want to be gathered with the likes of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions. You don't want to be with those other rulers, the dictators, because there are so many of them. So they refused the position of judge and ruling. Why did he accept gifts from the Khalifa? I'm not talking about a wage, gifts. He had a different philosophy to Abu Hanifa and the rest. They'd never accepted even gifts from the Khalifa himself, Khalifa al-Mansur and the others. However, his philosophy was like this. He wanted to keep a channel of good terms open between him and the Khalifa in order to give them a good advice, because he thought that if I can keep a channel with them, it'll help the community. This is his way of thinking. Secondly, he did not look at the wealth that the Khalifa had as being the wealth of the Khalifa. He assumed the wealth of the Khalifa, and he had a point to do so, was actually the wealth of the Muslims. It was from the zakat money, which was put into Bayt Mal al-Muslimin, social security of the Muslims, which actually belongs to the Mujahideen, the people who fought to protect the community in their country and their deen. And it also went to the poor people, and the teachers, the scholars, and the students, and the widows, and the orphans. Imam Malik was one of the teachers and the scholars, and he was also a mujahid. So he considered that he had right to this wealth anyway, and never considered to be the Khalifa's wealth. And I'm going to give you some evidence on why he did not consider that, inshallah, in a short while. So these are one of the reasons why I accept this gift. Otherwise, for any other reason, you shouldn't. There is a story about when he accepted an income from Al-Layth ibn Sa'd, his friend. He was so generous that one time he asked his friend the lathe for dye, you know, the dye that you color your clothes with. His students asked for some dye because they want to dye their clothing in. So he sent a letter to him asking for that, and a lathe sent him a generous amount of money. He sent him 1,000 dinars. He sent him extra dye, which if he sold it, he'd make an extra 1,000 dinars out of it. So it was a sizable amount, enough for all the people of Medina. So what he did was, his students did take this material, this dye, and they did sell it, and they made 1,000 dinars out of it for themselves. I think I'll leave the issue of the government and the imam to the end. I'd like to move a little bit to something else, which I haven't spoken about very in detail, and that is his clothing and his manner of the way he dressed. We said that asceticism, keeping away from the eases of the world and luxuries, Imam Malik was a little bit different to that. He considered staying away, or zuhud, asceticism, meaning staying away from the luxuries, comes from the heart and shows itself in your actions, but not in your appearance, for the following reasons. He said, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يُرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِ. Allah likes that his blessings on his servants are shown in public. So if Allah grants you something nice, Allah likes you to show it, but not to show off. To be humble about it, but not to show off. And to show this ni'mah with sincerity. Secondly, Imam Malik looked at himself as standing the position of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he had to be on his best decoration. Doesn't Allah say in the Quran, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. Decorate yourselves at every masjid, especially on a Jumu'ah, wear your best of clothing. So Imam Malik used to love to do that. And he considered that a man giving the knowledge has to be in the best presentation, and it had its own psychological effect on the people. It has its own psychological effect on the people. And this was the philosophy of Imam Malik. He had his dalil, he had his evidence, and anyone who rejected his evidence, well, he said, well, with respectfully, this is yours. There was a worshipper who was an ascetic. He sent a letter to Imam Malik one time, a abid who avoided these cities and used to live in the deserts in a hut, and used to abid, worshipper. So he sent a letter saying the following: O Imam, leave this eloquence and go to the deserts and live a simple life. Live a simple life in ibadah, in worship. And this is known to a group called, which later on appeared, formally appeared as the Sufis, who really dwell into this in a lot, but not to the certain group of Sufis, not to the Sufis, some of the Sufis we have today that do particular things that have no basis to the deen. And when we say Sufi, we mean those who are ascetics, who avoid the luxury. Imam Hassan al-Basri did that, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did that, Abu Bakr and Umar, in fact all the prophets were ascetics. They tried to avoid the world entering their hearts in every way, and they were humble. However, decoration on the outside is not going against the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when a man said, Ya Rasulullah, a person likes to wear nice shoes and nice clothing, he said, Inna Allaha jamilun yuhibbul jamal. Allah is beautiful, He loves beauty. So be beautiful inshaAllah, within Islamic limits of course. So Imam Malik replied to this ascetic, this abid, this mu'min. He said, Allah distributed, with great respect, Allah distributed the good actions among His creations the same way as He distributed their sustenance and livelihood. He gives some people the pleasure in salah more than the pleasure in salm, or in hajj more than the pleasure of zakat, for example. You happen to find your pleasure in abstinence from luxuries and beautification in worship. I find mine in ilm and knowledge, teaching people. I am content with what Allah has given me, and so I like to show it, and I hope that both of us are on the straight path. This is the way Imam Malik addressed it. The point of this is, look at the beautiful, the brotherhood and the respect and the niceness and the kindness they apply to each other, with a beautiful dua, with beautiful statements. We don't put each other down. At the end of the day, we want sincerity, inshaAllah, and we try to help each other, bi-idhnihi ta'ala. So you don't all have to be copycats of each other, This person likes to be a little bit more humble. This person likes to show his beauty. You don't have to copycat each other and feel put on the spot in front of others, thinking you're not doing the right thing. So Imam Malik, we said that he wore a ring, for example, with a black stone, and on it he had Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil. Doesn't mean that you can't do that because others don't do that. You don't have to be copycats. Take it easy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Taha ma anzalna alayka al-Quran litashqa. Oh, Ya Rasulullah, we have not sent this Quran upon you in order to make your life miserable and hard. This deen makes you happy. It should make you happy and flexible in the pleasure which Allah sent upon us. قُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ لِعِبَادِهِ الْمُتَّقِينَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Say, who is it, as Allah says, who is it that forbid the rightful, the righteous servants of Allah, the sincere servants, the humble servants of Allah, from taking pleasure in the beauties that Allah has created for them on earth? Imam Malik produced a monumental book, monumental work. It is called Al-Muwatta. Al-Muwatta lil Imam Malik. You probably have heard about it. This book is a collection of prophetic hadiths and some companion sayings, etc. It contains currently about 1,720 hadiths. And probably the first book of hadith, very popular book. And it was about 100 years before Bukhari and Muslim and the six books of hadith that we know about. So basically, some scholars say this was probably the first book of hadith ever. And it is one of the most authentic. Now this book, Al-Muwatta, it took about 11 years of Imam Malik's time to complete into chapters, and it was under chapters. And it came to us through one of the students of Abu Hanifa, Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, who studied under Malik for 3 years, and he propagated this book along with another scholar. It reached another scholar by the name of Asad ibn al-Furat, who was famous for propagating Islam to a place called Sicily. And a student of Malik wrote Al-Muwatta and the basics of the madhabs, spread through Africa and Spain. And this kitab, Al-Muwatta, was spread by his students. Imam Malik didn't write Al-Muwatta himself. He collected it, and his students actually put it together. The way they put it was, first of all, there was 100,000 hadiths in it. From the 100,000, 9,000 were taken as being most authentic. And from the 9,000, we finally ended up with 1,720 most authentic hadiths till today. Till today. And I mentioned last week that among them are several of them which Imam Malik narrated himself. We call it the golden chain. They are the most authentic hadiths existing today. So his students compiled after, it took about 30 years after Imam Malik for this book to be completely edited and filtered. Until now we have 1,720 hadiths that you can rely on in their authenticity. Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim and the others that you hear about, they have some of their hadiths with extra of them that maybe didn't reach Imam Malik in his time. Which gives us an example of why the madhabs did differ in some of their opinions. Imam al-Shafi'i says about Al-Muwatta, no book before the book of Allah was more authentic and accurate than Al-Muwatta. Keeping in mind that Bukhari and Muslim weren't existing at that time. Imam Shafi'i said this. Until today, we keep that. Imam al-Mansur, who was the Khalifa at that time, remember we mentioned him, it existed at the time of Abu Hanifa, he came up to Imam Malik at the Kaaba and he said to him, Ya Imam, I want this book to be copied and printed and distributed, and I want it to be the main source and every other book of hadith to be destroyed and burnt. It has to be the standard. Imam Malik said to him, no, don't do that. For there are people who receive knowledge from their imams and from different sources. And there could be sources that are not known to me. To take only my book and refuse all the rest is a dangerous thing to do. No, keep their hadiths, keep their statements, for maybe one day they'll add to Al-Muwatta and maybe, you know, more that people will learn from. Don't take away all the other knowledge just based on mine. For I am a man of knowledge and there's still more for me to learn. And this is the way the imams always spoke. We want to stay away from what the students of these imams did afterwards and what we do now, which is something called at-ta'assub al-madhabi, which is the strict following of the madhab and rejecting the others, not praying behind the person of another madhab because I think that their prayer is not accepted based on this and based on that. Wallahi, this is haram, this is firqah, this is division. These are differences of opinion and respect to each other. They learnt off each other. This person of this imam and the student of this imam, they were taught to each other. They respected each other all with every sense of the word. So this is the Kitab Al-Muwatta by Imam Ibn Malik, which we still have today. Imam Malik's greatest fear. Can anyone guess what is the greatest fear of all imams? Can anyone guess? The most frightening thing for all imams. What do you think? No. It is hellfire, that's for everybody. But I wanted to, something special about the imams they feared in this life.
When they make ijtihad and give a road fatwa.
Very good, good on you. When they make ijtihad, can deduce a matter to give a fatwa. Someone asked them a question and they've got to give them a verdict. This was the most frightening thing. This was the norm of all the scholars, especially these four imams and the ones like them and in their time. The greatest fear of imams is to answer questions. And this is from a characteristic called wara. I'll give you an example. Every time Imam Malik was asked for a verdict that didn't exist before, scholars hadn't dealt with it before, he would say to the person, wait. He'd go and make wudu, then he'd come back, he'd sit down, and he would start by saying, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There is no might and there is no power except with Allah. Then he would give the answer to the best of his knowledge. He used to say, مَا مِن شَيْءٍ أَشَدُّ عَلَيَّ مِنْ أَنْ أُسْأَلَ عَنْ مَسْأَلَةٍ مِنَ الْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ لِأَنَّ هَذَا قِطْعٌ مِنْ حُكْمِ اللَّهِ. He used to say, there is nothing more harder upon me in life than when I was asked a question about halal or haram, is this permissible or not? Because I am representing the hukm, the ruling of Allah Himself, the creator of the world. Brothers and sisters, this is a very important and serious matter for all of us to adhere to. So be very careful about this issue. So the scholar's form of decoration was a common motto. Guess what it was? The common motto, the form of decoration of the scholars was, I do not know. Would you imagine? I do not know. And I'll give you an example. Al-Haythami, which was one of the students of Imam Malik, says, I witnessed Imam Malik being asked about 48 issues, matters, on separate occasions. And he answered only 30, he said, he replied to 32 out of 48 of them, so two-thirds, he replied to them, La Adri, I do not know. 32 out of 48. So how many did he actually answer? 48 take away 32? 16. He answered 16, and 32 he said, I don't know. We're talking about the great imam. Abu Darda, one of the Sahabas, he says, to say I do not know is half of knowledge. To say I do not know is half of knowledge. And this is the meaning, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. The ones who truly fear Allah are the scholars. There is a story about a Moroccan, talking about the humbleness. A Moroccan from Morocco, which was about 4 months' journey to reach Medina, he had a question which all of the imams of Morocco could not answer him. So he traveled for 4 months with a message from the imam saying, there is no more knowledgeable scholar on the face of the earth than Imam Malik. Go to him in Medina and get us the answer for your verdict, for your question. So he set out for 4 months, this Moroccan man. We don't know who he is, but maybe I don't know who he is. When he reached Imam Malik, you can imagine the desert and the heat and the struggle. When he arrived, he asked Imam Malik the question. Imam Malik met and made wudu, came and sat down, said, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, stood up and said to him, give me till tomorrow. The next day, he did the same thing and he sat down and he said to him, my answer is, I do not know. The Moroccan student stood up and said, Ya Imam, with all due respect, the imams of Morocco are waiting for my answer and I've traveled 4 months And now I have to return another 4 months. So how many is that? 8 months to get the answer. I can't say to them, the great Imam says, I do not know. The Imam looked at him, and as I said, the man of aura, he said to him, well then go and tell your scholars that Imam Malik says he doesn't know. The Moroccan went back and this is what he told them. I do not know. Because this can earn him this place in hellfire. If he knew that he had made a mistake, he'd gather his students and then he would clarify his mistake in front of all his students. That's something very heavy to do. Listen, students, I said this before and I've made a mistake. This is what the correct answer is. This is why the Khalifa Abu Ja'far al-Mansur in Hajj, he came and asked him a few questions. And then he said to him, I have decided to take your book and make copies and spread it throughout the world. And he said to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen la taf'al, please don't do it. Don't force the people to accept something when I am a man who can make mistakes, tomorrow I may change. And fa'alan, really, as we said, the Muwatta was changed afterwards until it was filtered. My brothers and sisters in Islam, the character of Imam Malik is what stood out. Yahya ibn Yahya, the student of his, as we mentioned before, he said, after I graduated from the school of Imam Malik, I spent one extra whole year with him. He's graduated. Imam Malik has said that, khalas, now you are free, you've graduated, you are now qualified to give classes and so on. He said, I spent one extra year after graduating with Imam Malik, and the only reason I spent it was to learn Imam Malik's etiquettes. Different to Abu Hanifa, when Imam Malik accepted gifts, as we said before, I just want to say that, especially for someone like Al-Mansur, Imam Malik did accept them from him. When Imam Abu Hanifa used to trick the Khalifa, when he offered him a gift, he used to say, keep it with you, you know, because there's lots of thieves, they'll steal it off me. Abu Hanifa. But this was a trick for him to not take the wealth. Later on, when Abu Hanifa died, Al-Mansur, the Khalifa, found out that Imam Abu Hanifa himself, he was like the banker for his students. He used to keep their money with him. And he used to say to the Khalifa, keep my money with you because there's thieves, because he didn't want it. As for Imam Malik, he did the opposite. And I want to mention now, to explain how Imam Malik was not a government scholar because he accepted gifts, because some people said this after him about Imam Malik. And this was not good. Some people had grudges about it. Imam Malik, he went against the norms, yes, of the scholars, which is to accept the gifts from the scholars. He considered the stereotype of scholars, meaning that they don't accept the government and that they enter, you know, what's the stereotype of scholars? They're always entering the palaces of the umara, of the rulers, and they're telling them off about what they're doing. They stand firm about it. They never accept anything on it. Like Imam Abu Hanifa, even though he never fought physically the corrupt government, he did fund rebels. He funded rebels in an indirect way to straighten the government up. He did do that. Imam Malik was a little bit different. He was powerful and not undermined. And he actually had to face an ordeal and torture. I'd like to say that all four imams, even though they had different ways of dealing with the government, all of them got imprisoned and all of them got tortured, including Imam Malik. Even with the way Imam Malik dealt with them, he had a downwards, upwards approach, down, up approach. The rest of them had up, down approach, get into the palace and change. He thought, no, come up towards them and then change. Imam Malik witnessed the fall of the Umayyad dynasty and the rise of the Abbasid dynasty. He witnessed 8 khalifas in the time of the Umayyad dynasty and 5 khalifas in the time of the Abbasid dynasty. He lived 90 years, or 86 or 90 years, making him the longest living among the 4 imams. Imam Shafi lived only 54 years, subhanAllah. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, about 70, and Imam Abu Hanifa, about 70 years. Imam Malik, as I said, not a government scholar. Once Harun al-Rashid, I'll give you an example of why he wasn't a government scholar and why this gift didn't fool him. There was a story of one of the Khalifas named Harun al-Rashid at his time. He once made an oath to do something, and then he broke that oath. The Khalifa, Harun al-Rashid, famous. He made an oath, he said, Wallahi, I'm going to do this. And then he broke that, he didn't do it. Now we all know that you have to expiate an oath if you don't do it. The way you expiate it is, you have to follow this order, you have to free a slave. If you're unable to free a slave, you've got to feed 10 poor people. If you're unable to feed 10 poor people, then you must fast 3 days in a row. The way you expiate is the things that are hardest for you. So the Harun al-Rashid, the Khalifa, he called and said, what should I do? The other scholars said to him, you can take any of the above three options. Imam Malik, however, said to him, no, you have to fast 3 days. Harun al-Rashid said, but I can do any of the others. I can free a slave. I've got money to pay for 10 people. Why should I fast 3 days? The Imam said to him courageously without fear, but the money you have does not belong to you, but to the Muslims. And if we were to return all the wealth that you have to their rightful owners, you'll have nothing. So you don't qualify to free a slave or to pay to 10 people. You'll end up poor. You'll have nothing. Like Amr ibn Abdul Aziz, the great, considered to one of the fifth righteous khalifas. He died poor man, and he was the khalifa. So this is what he said to him. He said, your money is for the Muslims. If we were to take it away, you'll be a poor person. So my point is, fast 3 days. The point is that Imam Malik was courageous, and this is proof that him taking the gifts did not mean that he was a government puppet like some of the scholars today. And he, if you didn't agree with him, he didn't mind. This was his way, he stuck to it with his dalil. He was not a government scholar. Once Harun al-Rashid, he gave 3,000 dirhams to Imam Malik. And he said to him, when these 3,000 dirhams reach you, I want you to come immediately to my palace with my royal order. He had to leave Medina and go to Iraq, to Baghdad. Now what did we say last week? Imam Malik never left Medina, and he insisted on never ever leaving it. In fact, he never rode on a horse or a camel or a vehicle, because he believed, as an imam, how dare he lift his legs off the ground while the Prophet's body is in the ground. This was him. Imam, he thought he was the role model. He had to have really high stakes. Doesn't apply to us, but him. A letter to come to me to Baghdad because of the 3,000 dinars. He sent the 3,000 dinars back, saying to him, I will never leave Medina. In other words, keep dreaming. That's basically what he was saying. So what did Harun al-Rashid do? To show you how much they respected him, he sent him double. 6,000 dirhams with no conditions. So Imam Malik looked at the wealth and looked at his students and says, "Man taraka shay'an lillahi awwadahu Allahu khayran min." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whoever leaves something for the sake of Allah, Allah will give him something better. And he distributed among his students and himself. The Khalifas sent their own children to Imam Malik. In fact, some of the Khalifas that became Khalifas were ex-students of Imam Malik. Can you imagine? Imam Malik coming in. And this is one of the stories. He used to enter the palace of the Khalifa, and he refused, I'm almost done inshallah, he refused to ever sit in the back. You know, when you enter on the palace, there's people in front, you can't, you know, walk among the people just so you can have VIP. Imam Malik insisted on a VIP. Not only to sit in the front, but next to the Khalifa. Does anyone know why? I have no time to quiz you, so I'll just say it anyway. I know the adhan is soon. Imam Malik wanted to teach the people that the scholars are more important and powerful than even the Khalifas. And that is true. It is not the Khalifas who are the inheritors of the prophets, it is the ulama who are the inheritors of the prophets. And he wanted to show the people that the ilm of the Prophet ﷺ is the first rule, not the rule of the Khalifa. So he always insisted. And when he went to the palace, I don't mean in Baghdad, residential palaces in Medina and Mecca. When he entered, he would look at the Khalifa and see like large people, like the way you're sitting here, from the back. People would be calling, he'd call out. He says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. He'd look up at him. And he'll say to him, will you accept for your Imam to sit at the back? And the Khalifa would say to him, no, everyone open up, open up. And he'd let him come to sit right next to him. When the Imam sat next to the Khalifa, he would say to him the following words, listen to them. The Imam, the Khalifa, so imagine now, the Khalifa say, Imam's at the back, says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he says, come, come, open the space. Comes and sits right next to him on the same chair. And then the Imam would look at him before the Khalifa would speak. And he would say to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, O leader of the believers, Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tarfa'u aswatakum fawqa sawti an-nabi. O you who believe, do not raise your voice over the voice of the Prophet. I'm here to speak the hadith of the Prophet, so don't raise your voice over mine, because it is not me speaking, it is the Prophet speaking. And by this, the Khalifa had to lower his voice in front of the Imam. This is what I mean by the man of aura. He always spoke the truth. Imam Malik one day enters one of the residential palace of the Khalifa and he asks for a cup of water. So they give him a royal glass. The royal glasses, they were glass and they had a silver ring around them, made of silver. Imam Malik looked at this glass of the silver ring. He didn't say a word. He put the cup down, did not take a sip of it, and walked out. At that time, the Khalifa was Al-Mahdi. His name was Al-Mahdi, one of his ex-students. And he said, where are you going, Ya Imam? Why are you leaving? And the Imam says, I do not drink from a cup which has silver around it. The Khalifa Al-Mahdi then ordered all the silver rings to be taken, removed from the cups of the palace. Just showing you that if he was a government scholar, would he say something like that? Never. Now, lastly, because of this truth, something happened and he had to face a terrible ordeal. He clashed with the state. Every imam clashed with the state. A revolution against Abu Ja'far al-Mansur began. And Imam Abu Hanifa was about in his 60s at that time. A revolution began against Abu Ja'far al-Mansur's rule, they consider regime. And the people who started this revolution were people from the Prophet's family. They were called the Alawites, the Alawis. Not the Alawis of today. When you say Alawites, historically, it meant the bloodline of the Prophet ﷺ. They were from Ali radiallahu anhu, Fatima, those. Yani. Those are the people who made a revolution against it. And the leader of the revolutionists was led by Muhammad al-Nafs al-Zakiyya, who was a descendant of Imam Hassan, of Hassan radiallahu anhu, al-Hassan ibn Ali radiallahu anhu, the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ. And Imam Malik, He supported the leader of this movement. And he wished him success in a letter or verbally, because he thought that if he became the new ruler, if Muhammad, Imam Muhammad al-Nafs al-Zakiyya, great Imam, if he became the new ruler, then it would be better. It would be better. This is what Imam Malik thought on the inside. According to his students, this is what they said. They said, Imam Malik considered if he became a better ruler, the Ummah of the Muslims would be in a better way. So one day, the Imam was asked. What happened was, the governor of Medina, he wanted to be the governor. So he started going around basically forcing the people to pledge allegiance for him, meaning to vote for him and pledge allegiance. You accept me. So there was a bit of a force happening. And the people didn't like this, so the revolution increased. One day, someone asked the Imam Malik a question, which had a political motive behind it. And Imam Malik knew this, is very smart. The question was, if a man was forced to divorce his wife, and he divorced her, does the divorce count? Imam Malik said, in fiqh and Islam, Nothing is valid out of force. Nothing. Anything that is forced is not valid. So if the man divorces his wife because he's forced, divorce her. Divorce her. And if divorced, it's not counted. This had a political meaning. Meaning, allegiance to the ruler. If you are compelled, it's invalid. He's an invalid ruler. This was a big problem. Huge problem. So the Khalifa found out, and he sent news for the Imam to stop saying what he was saying and never to repeat that rule, that verdict again. The Imam replied, "I cannot conceal knowledge if I know it." So they sent a spy to one of his circles, and the spy asked the question again to check if this Imam really meant what he's saying, to test him. So he asked him the question, and the Imam answered him exactly the same answer as before, knowing the political consequence of it. The result of this was, there was an order to capture Imam Malik in Medina to the governor, the prince of Medina. They captured him, imprisoned him, and they tortured him. He was beaten so badly until his arms became disabled. He couldn't lift his arms for months. And his shoulder, his right shoulder, was dislocated. Imagine an imam with all his aura. And probably among the officials were his ex-students. How can you beat an imam like, how could they beat him? To the point where his arms became disabled for months and his arm was dislocated from his body. And he would not refuse. He would not go back on his word. In that time, Imam Malik prayed a little while with his arms down. This is documented. And there are some people who wanted to make a joke out of this. I don't know why, in this time, which still exists till today with some sincere people, saying that the school of thought of Imam Malik considers that you should pray with your arms down. There is no evidence for this in the school of Imam Malik, except this situation, because he was beaten on his arms. Anybody, if you can't stand, you sit. So this is a funny thing which occurred, and I don't know where people got this from. The imams, the great imams, don't agree with this. So the Malikis do not, should not really leave their arms down. I'm not going to go into too much fiqh about it. Then there was a second revolt. When they heard about Imam Malik being tortured this way, his students got up. You mess with his students? These are the students that if you entered his circle and you just raised your voice, I know time's up. Raised your voice, they'll beat you. So Imam al-Mansur, Khalifa al-Mansur sent a letter straight away to the Khalifa, to Imam Malik, saying, no, he did not send that. He came in person to Medina and he says, "I apologize, ya Imam. I did not order this. Please tell me what you need and I will give you. And I've sacked the governor and I've humiliated him," and so on. This is what he claimed. And Imam Malik, therefore, was not a government scholar. The end of his life of Imam Malik after that, he became very ill at the age of 90, and he could not go to the masjid for a little while. He died at the age of 90 years. In introduction to next week's lesson, I just want to say one very small story, inshallah. A young man, the age of about 13 years old, in the time of Imam Malik, when Imam Malik was in his middle ages, a young boy by the age of 13, his mother from Mecca, his mother said to him, "My son, you are now well known. You have memorized the whole Quran and you have memorized hadith and you have memorized poetry. I want to send you to Imam Malik to learn his adab, his character, before you learn his knowledge." So she got him ready and she wrote a letter to the prince of Mecca, the governor of Mecca, who happened to be her cousin, this woman's cousin. Are you with me? She wrote a letter to him to send a letter to the governor of Medina to go with her son to Imam Malik, basically to intercede for him, to become his teacher. So this young boy took this letter from his mother, from the governor of Mecca, and she packed him some food and sent him off, young 13-year-old going through the deserts to Medina, seeking knowledge. He reached the governor of Medina and gave him the letter of the governor of Mecca. And the governor of Medina, his face changed. He started to sweat. The young boy looked at him and said, "What's wrong?" He said, "Wallahi, if the governor of Mecca asked me to walk barefooted in the middle of the desert with nothing on my head, it would be easier than for me to go to Imam Malik's house." Because he had so much respect for him. So the boy innocently said to him, "Well, you don't have to go to him, make him come to you." He forgot that Imam Malik doesn't, it's not as simple as it going to the officials, no way. So he laughed, the governor of Medina laughed, and he said, "Come on, let's go." So he went to Imam Malik's house. They knocked on the door, and the housemaid, the servant of Imam Malik, answered, and they asked for Imam Malik, the prince, the governor of Medina. She said to him, "Listen, if there is a religious question, right now is not the time. Write it on a paper and he will answer it for you. If you want to learn hadith, go to his circles of Daras, they'll be at a certain time. And if it's a government issue, this is not the time, there's another time for it." So the governor of Medina says, "I have a letter for him from the prince of Mecca." So then the young boy says, a big, tall man, blonde, white, colored eyes, unexpected from the people of Medina, came to the door. Says, "I looked up at him, and the servant lady brought him a chair, he sat on it. And then he said, 'What does the governor of Mecca want from me?' And the governor of Medina just gave him the paper without a word. When Imam Malik read this paper, he threw the paper away saying, 'La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah.' Has it come to this that knowledge now needs connections?" He looked at the young boy and the young boy said to him, "Aslah Allahu Shaykh." May Allah straighten the path of the Shaykh. Out of respect, young boy. He said to him, "I am a Qurashi. I am from the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So now, basically, he obliged the Imam to listen to him. You have to respect the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. "Ana Qurashi. I have memorized the Quran at the age of 7. And your Muwatta, the whole of it, I've memorized it with this chain of narrations by the age of 10. My mother sent me here to learn from you." Imam Malik looked at him and said, "Ya ghulam, O young boy, ittaqillah, fear Allah, wajtanib al-ma'asi, and stay away from sins. If you do so, there will be something of your future if you apply these two advices." Does anyone know who the young boy was? No, not Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He was Imam, yes, he was going to say it. He was Imam al-Shafi'i. Are you 13? So 13-year-old gave me the name of the 13-year-old boy. He was, mashallah, fatahallahu alayhi wa ala walidayk. So he was Imam Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i. You thought he wasn't going to be a Shafi'i, didn't you? So it was Imam Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i. Next week, inshallah, we will begin the story of Imam al-Shafi'i. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على محمد رسول الله. اللهم صل على محمد نبي الله. اللهم صل على محمد رسول الله. اللهم صل على محمد.